The speaker is Nikos Stylianopoulos from University of Cyprus. He will speak about Christoffel, Bergman, Faber boundary behavior. Please.
Okay. Good. Thank you very much. It was Szegő there, but he decided to drop out. You see why. I'll start by hello to everyone from Nicosia, Cyprus. We have a very nice weather here. I'm at the departmental office. I'll start by thanking the co-chairman of the meeting, the three co-chairmen, for the invitation. I'm very proud of it. It's an honor for me. I thank very much Sasha Dekarev, Jesus De Hesa, and Walter Vanasse for the invitation in the first place. I'm very sad that I couldn't have made it, probably to be there. I'm happy to be with you in this way, but it would have been more fun in sitting with all of you, all the participants in this great place of Sochi. I have to congratulate the local organizing committee, Vladimir Lisov, Masa Lapik, Elia Lopatin, and Alexei Suplev for all the effort. I'm sure they have made a lot of effort. They have put a lot of time in order to organize this conference. I know it is very difficult in this away fashion, not in person. So please enjoy, join me in giving to them a round of applause for all the work they have done. I appreciate very much, and I hope in the near future to be able to see you in person at this great serious mathematical center. So it's about orthogonal polynomials. I just mentioning that in the abstract was also Szegő name there, but he decided to drop out because he will not fit in the frame in this short time. So Elwin Christoffel, German mathematician, Georg Faber, I think he was a graph, a count, you see by his elegant looks. Stefan Bergman, this is a very important case. He was Polish born into a Jewish family, educated in Berlin, spent 6 years before 1939 in Moscow, and then he immigrated in the USA, where he became a citizen. So the underground of all this, what I'm going to say, it's orthonormal polynomials. Okay, so everything is familiar here. We have a finite a positive measure. Borel is redundant here because we have CAOPA support. It has to be Borel the measures, but we have to have infinite support so that we can build up the whole series of orthogonal polynomials. So this is the related inner product, very familiar, familiar forms here. The norm denoted this way. We have the series, the whole series of orthonormal polynomials that is madely unique by requiring the leading coefficient to be positive. By the way, you see me going up and down. It is probably the first time I'm giving a lecture sitting. I gave the whole series, the semester, the three semesters at the University of Cyprus, the lectures by studying in the my green board, and I was always studying. So this is something strange for me, sitting down and talking. And by the way, there is something wrong with me today. Hey, Sasa, you know what is it? What is wrong with me today? No tie, no white shirt. Anyway, okay.
Okay. Because my grandson, he is doing this distance study in a school, and he even has no trousers. Yes, so just only a tie.
I'm assure you, I'm decent down there. Okay, shorts, but decent. So the monic polynomials coming out this way have an excellent and very important extremal property. They minimize the L2 norm amongst all the monic polynomials of the same degree. Incidentally, this minimum is 1 over the coefficient. A related extremal problem leads to the sequence of Christoffel functions. These are functions, not polynomials. They satisfy they defined as the infimum of all polynomials of degree n. So degree n is there that are normalized to be one at z, at the same time to give the infinite in this L2 norm square. All the lecture will be about the Christoffel functions defined this way. It is an easy constituent of the Cauchy's force inequality that actually these Christoffel functions are defined as the inverse of the diagonal of the Christoffel-Darboux kernel. This is the Christoffel-Darboux kernel defined in terms of orthonormal polynomials, has a conjugate here. It is very easy to see that this is a kernel for the polynomials of degree n. And please keep in mind, in particular, that at any point in the diagonal, we have this very simple and nice equality. So the first result is about general measures. Later on, I will be using a specific type of moment measures, typically that are absolutely continuous with respect to the area measure. So there's no assumption here about the moments here, other than being positive with finite support, so infinite support. So this is a remarkable result of Abro-Ladd that says that in the limit, the Christoffel functions, they have a say on the measure. You see, this is for any at the boundary points. Okay, so if there are no atomic measures, this will be zero. Otherwise, will be cuts the atomic measures. So an immediate corollary here says that the Lim soup on the boundary points. This is on the boundary points, is infinity in that way. So at this will obviously this give rise to how to detect the discrete spectrum of the measure in the boundary. Okay, we'll come back to this 1/2 factor here, which is it's very special. I'll mention here a recent result. This is an easy constituent of actually the Runge's theorem that has appeared in the 100th celebration of Sbornik mathematics. And this is locally uniformly in omega. So this already started showing that these Christoffel functions have to do with the detection of the support of the measure, and we'll come back later in a more specific way. So here we are. Okay. So now I come to what is called the configuration that we call archipelago. This is a finite union of system of disjoint and mutually exterior journal domains at positive distance, like the here. So we have some islands, all together is archipelago. The measure now will be the area measure on this configuration. And from now on, I'm going to drop the mu in the definition of the polynomials in the Christoffel function. So the measure is highlighted here. So we have the unique sequence of normal polynomials with respect to the area measure, and these are generally called Bergman polynomials. Here's the name, of the Stefan Bergman in the title. So the first result for this archipelago I'm going to mention, it's a result, joint result with Bon Gustafsson, Mihai Putinar, and Ed Saf. That was a Nobel Wolf affair in, It was research in pairs meeting, where, although we were four of us there. So this, the behavior of the Christoffel functions is encapsulated here inside the domains. It behaves, cannot decay faster than the distance from the boundary. This is a musical sequence. Actually, this is hyperbolic metric result, and you don't have to have Jordan domain, and open simply connected domain will do. But for the other two results, we had to assume that every boundary curve is analytic. And in this case, this is the behavior on the boundary. This equivalent sign here means that there are positive functions, so that each one of them is bounded from the left at the other, at the right times the other guy here. So this says that on the boundary, the Christoffel functions behave like 1/n². However, outside the domain here, let's say in the, this is the archipelago, this is the islands, in the sea, inside the sea, they decay very fast towards zero. This is the green function with polar infinity of omega. Omega always will be the complement, the component of the complement of underlying set that contains infinity. So this is the unbounded component of the complement of G bar. The green functions goes in, it's a positive harmonic function that has a logarithmic singularity at infinity. It goes from zero from the boundary to infinity at the point of infinity. So this grows as we go away of the boundary. So this goes very fast to zero. And therefore, this is a perfect domain functional in reconstructing the support of the measure from the moments. The idea is you have the area moments, and then from the area moments, you construct, compute the orthonormal polynomials, the Bergman polynomials, then you form the Christoffel function. And by plotting level lines of the Christoffel function, you can identify the support of the measure. So this is an actual algorithm. This is one of big part of this reference here. And where we use rather, instead of the Christoffel function, the square root. So we have n rather than n square there. So now I come from for results regarding the behavior on the boundary. Here we had added the assumption the boundary is analytic. We have that the Christoffel function behave 1/n² on the boundary. And this has, I'm going to report on some very elegant results on the crystal, on the behavior of the Christoffel function on the boundary. Other much weaker assumptions. Here we have the measure. It's actually a measure absolutely continuous to the area measure. This weight function here, it has to satisfy this very weak condition, continuous positive near the boundary. And then under this condition, Vilmos Totic, by using a very hard analysis, basic analysis, using extending in a very elegant way Hilbert-Lemniscate theorem in polynomial mappings, has been able to show that to obtain this wonderful equality here for the behavior on Christoffel functions on the boundary. So The Z node will be a boundary point on the boundary of the domains here, but it has to be the center for some C2 Jordan subarc. Under this assumption, then Vilmos managed to establish this limit here. So here it's the outward normal derivative. So actually, this is a special part of a much more general result that under the assumption that the measure belongs to the class red class of measures, and having this form where W is continuous under in a small in a open disk around Z node, so this is a very local assumption, will have this result at the around at the, for the behavior at Z node. So this is this is limit, but it has to be smooth here. In what I'm going to report here is a byproduct actually of results of Vilmos Totic and Tamas Varga on the work for fast decreasing polynomials and Chebyshev polynomials. This is a byproduct where at exactly at the corner that formed by two C1 plus arcs of exterior angle omega times pi, but omega has to be greater than or equal than one, then they establish this behavior on the corner point of the Christoffel functions. You see, if you put one here, you get this result, not get it agrees with this specific result of limit. So Christoffel archipelagos, we are in archipelagos. Now we move to one island case, and what I'm going to report is the specific behavior of the Christoffel functions. In this case, we have the area measure, so it's one island case. This is a recent result obtained with Ben Beckerman, Mihai Putinar, and staff, where in this case, under the assumption that the boundary here, gamma, is piecewise analytic without cusps, we have obtained this behavior of the Christoffel function locally uniformly in omega. So a few comments here are due. This is in omega again, okay? So the reason that we had to assume in this case that the boundary curves were all of them analytic, it was because by this time we didn't have the strong asymptotics in omega of the Bergman polynomial. So this is based on that. What is important to observe here that this order, one over n, the order here, which is exact, by the way, this is sharp here, even the unit disk will show that this result is sharp. It has in the denominator the distance for the boundary. So the is not the idea moving from the interior to the boundary, it is not going to work, because the boundary here, this one over distance will blow up and will have infinity here. The other thing is that in this specific case, the green function has this form. And yeah, I have to mention here that the phi is the normalized exterior conformal map going from omega onto to the exterior of the unit circle, and it's normalized that way. We have to have positive, to be positive in infinity. At infinity, then in this case, the exterior conformal map phi and the green function are related in this simple way. And what appears here in Totic's estimate, let me see where we are here, in this case, the green function, this derivative, is nothing but the phi prime at z. So this how they are related. In the case, again, in the case of at corner points on the boundary, this is a recent work by Vladimir Andreevsky, where he establishes the sharp estimates, the exact behavior at corner points, under the assumption the domain is a quasi-disk. In other words, the boundary, is a quasi-conformal curve. In this case, under the assumption that the exterior angle of the opening angle is omega, and omega can be anything from zero to two, and this angle is formed by Dini smooth arcs, then Andreevsky has established this exact behavior, which is in accordance with a previous one. The paper is about sharp estimates for quasi-disks. So let's. So our purpose here is to have not the estimates, sharp estimates, in at the corner points, but like in the middle of C2 arcs in a dotics results, to have limit at corner points. So this is what we will be trying to do from now on. So in order to do that, one way to do it is to have the exact behavior of the Bergman polynomials at corner points in the case where we have piecewise analytic without cusps boundary. So what we have available up to now is that it's not the exact behavior, but rather a sharp upper bound. So if gamma is piecewise analytic without cusps, z naught will be a corner point with exterior angle here it has to be omega, not omega j, then this is a sharp upper bound. This constant here depends on gamma and on z naught. It depends also on the point. It's not uniform. And this yields automatically that if omega is less than 1 over 2, then the limit of there is 0 of the Bergman polynomials. And if we recall Abro-Lage, then it comes out that this exponent here is sharp. If z naught is inside an analytic sub arc, then hence omega, in this case the omega is 1, then in order to obtain this result, we have used Totic's fine result on the limit at this point, which is, that's how we got it. Oops. So it went twice. Okay, so what I'm going to do now, having not been able to obtain the limit of the Christoffel, the Bergman polynomials at the boundary of the domain, I dare a conjecture, a bold conjecture. So let me explain to you under this the usual assumption. Then the conjecture says that the Bergman polynomials on the boundary are behave like that, okay? Where this function here goes to zero. So what is here? This is omega, the angle. This is the usual gamma function. This is phi, the exterior conformal map, which is has a homeomorphic extension from the interior to the boundary, which is one to one and continuous in both directions. And there is a mysterious constant here. I'm not going to reveal what this is. A1, okay, that appears here. And I'm going to test this conjecture first numerically. So this is the specific example we use. There are two intersecting circles. We are going to see the shape in the moment. We'll take 2 points in the sectors to check, and just to I'm going to mention how the results I'm going to present were obtained. So this is the way we did it. We compute the Bergman polynomials by using the Arnaud variation of the Gram-Schmidt algorithm. This is where it can be shown that when you use Gram-Schmidt, the main concern is instability. It's the worst instable case unless you have the unit circle. A circle centered at the origin. So one main concern is how stable or stable is the method you use to compute. Here, there is a number of indicators that measure the instability. There is one indicator introduced in the 50s by Taylor, and by using this indicator, it has been shown that the method is indeed stable. I commend to you a very recent article in the Sam Review, Vandermonde with Arnoldi, by Brubeck, Nakatsukasa, et Trefeden, where they use this idea of Arnoldi, Gram-Schmidt, making waters in polynomial fitting. So this is the shape we are going to consider. And in order to, if you are not convinced what from the previous slide, what I have done here, we have computed the zeros of the polynomials of degrees 80, 100, 120. I forgot to mention all the computations were carried out in Maple 16, with Maple 16 in a MacBook Pro by using 128 significant figures. This is what Bern asked the other day, Jake, about the significant figures used. In order to convince a bit more about the stability in the computation, we have picture here the zeros of the Bergman polynomials. And as you see, it's according with this result here that says that obtained with EDSAF, that says in this specific case, because of the non-convex angles we have here, the normalized count zero of measures of the Bergman polynomials tends to the equilibrium measure on the boundary. This is what is remarkable here is that this is for the whole sequence of natural numbers, not some specific subsequence. This result was mentioned by Jacob the other day in regard with the distribution of the zeros of the Chebyshev polynomials in cases where you have angles bigger than or inward pointing angles. So you see here, you observe here a reluctance of the zeros to go to minus I the tie. This is due to the fact that the equilibrium measure is given, this is the arc length measure, and this is prime z here, a phi prime z here. And very naturally, Andrei may ask, the phi is not analytic at the corner points, what we have here, but in a while you'll be convinced that this phi here prime will be zero at the corner point. So this explains the reluctance on the plot of the zeros on the plot to approach the corner points. So this is the explanation of what is there. This is how the mysterious constants A1 came in the conjecture. This is a result of Lehmann, goes back to 1957, and what it gives you, it in the case of a corner formed by two analytic arcs of opening omega pi, 2 is included here, it gives you an expansion around the corner. This is valid around the corner. It has many terms here, it goes down all the way. Logarithmic terms might appear, but they don't appear very soon. They don't appear in the case where Z naught is formed by two straight line segments. And in this sense, what you see here is nothing more than the expansion of this form coming out of the Szegő-Christoffel transformation at the corner point. So it's a kind of generalization in two analytic arcs. So if omega is less than one, then here this is bigger than zero. And therefore, if you take the limit as z going to z naught, this phi prime naught at z naught will give you zero. That's what it was appearing before. So here are the numbers. In this case, we form the conjecture. We check the conjecture at the corner points. What one corner point, which is I here, at one analytic corner, let's say, were here at this point here. So first, the results for I. These are the particulars. This is the form that the conjecture takes now. And see what we check here, the way that this B goes to zero, the degrees are up to 120. This is what is pictured here. Probably this is not very convincing, but if we go to other north corner point, then I think it's a bit more evidence that indeed the conjecture is true. So how the motivation of the conjecture came? In order to explain this, I have to introduce the normalized Faber polynomials. Again, the leading is the expansion around infinity of the exterior conform map. Not this gamma here is one over the capacity. This is positive one, the capacity of the Jordan curve. The domain, the way we define our Faber polynomials, it is we take this Lorentz series expansion at infinity, form the polynomial part. This is power n here. And this will be the Faber polynomials we consider. The other part is analytic in omega, even at infinity, what is remaining here, it starts with 1 over z squared. So we define our normalized Faber polynomials, small fn, in this way, you see here. And in order, the reason we do this, it's the match the Bergman polynomial. So the Faber polynomials are some kind of easiest substitute for Bergman polynomials. This is the behavior of the Faber polynomials around the corner. You expect so because they are defined by using Faber, the exterior conformal map phi. And for this, we have the local expansion here from Lehmann, where it is. From Lehmann, we have the behavior at corner points. So you expect, as you expect, Faber polynomials will be have a specific computable behavior at corner points. Actually, this was first observed. This result was first observed. You see, Szegő managed to squeeze its name here. This expansion first appeared in the very famous paper of Szegő about the proof of Markov inequality, where he extended it in the corners, the local Markov inequality. And this Faber polynomials gave him an example of exactness in the power of an alpha. It was in the paper. What he used there, he established this inequality, this behavior for polynomial domains, because he used the Szegő-Christoffel transformation expansion at corner points. The new thing about Igor's Pritzker result is that the assumption is that the boundary gamma is rectifiable and gamma is formed by two analytic arcs, exterior angle omega over pi, two is included, and then he gave this expansion for Faber polynomial, local expansion for Faber polynomials. In order to compare and show with more emphasis that moving to the boundary doesn't help, I quote here a very classical result about Faber polynomials, just a continuum with the omega to be the complement, the outside of the continuum is enough, no of Jordan or whatever boundaries. This quotes the behavior in omega, showing that this was taken out by the famous book by P.K. Sweting, series of Faber polynomials. And you see from here, this is decays geometrically to zero. You see from here that if you move towards the boundary has corner points, it doesn't work because here we have n with some power, which this is a square root. It's only when omega is one. If it omega is not one, this shows the discrepancy. So somehow gives the idea that moving from the interior to the corner, the boundary with corners, it doesn't work. So the theoretical motivation, how much time I have before I go to this? How much time I have? Eh?
You have about 3 or 5 minutes.
All right, okay. So this is theoretical motivation. It is that at the interior, Faber and Bergman behave the same. This is how this is the difference encoded in the L2 norm square. In locally uniformly, this is the behavior. Actually, in a recent work with Ben Beckerman, this 1 over square root of n was improved to 1 over n, but at least me, it didn't help me in getting the boundary asymptotics for the Bergman polynomials. This is the difference on the boundary, quoted from this publication here. Still, here it's a constant where actually we want to have something decaying in zero. So the conjecture actually calls for this to prove that the comparison between on the boundary Faber and Bergman goes to zero. So that was the theoretical motivation. And here comes a suggestion. So in order to have the kernel, the Christoffel Darboux kernel that gave us the Christoffel functions, just use the Faber polynomials here. Mm-hmm. Just observe that on the diagonal, this is positive because in the case where the constant Faber polynomial is positive, then it's not difficult to show that the L2 norm of this, let's say functional here, this polynomial here is less or equal than the diagonal. In the case of the Christoffel Darboux kernel, we have equality here. So it gets inequality. And then from the minimal property of Christoffel functions, it's very easy to see using this theorem that it's a substitute. 1 over this kernel provides an upper bound for the Christoffel functions. It's just an upper bound. But what is remarkable is that if you take in the case of two analytic arcs meeting at the angle pi, so omega is one, I'm just giving some examples here. Then it's not difficult because we know the behavior of the Faber polynomials encoded here. Let me see where it is. On the boundary. So we use this expansion here. It's not difficult at all to show that in this case, n squared times this replacement is this. And this is in perfect agreement with the Vilmos-Totic result, where now instead of the Christoffel functions, we have this guy here, just to, this is one over the other. It looks like we have equality here. Although here we have an inequality, so they behave very fine, the polynomial, even matching the behavior on the boundary with the Christoffel function. So this is a proposition for a replacement which is much more easier to compute. And just to quote a case where this is somewhat new, because here we have a cusp, outward point cusp, then even in this case, we have this result, the limit, where A1 is the constant coming from the Lehmann expansion. So that's all I had to say. And, it has been wonderful even talking at distance with you. And thank you very much for being with me.
Thank you very much for the talk. Any questions or comments, please?
I have a question.
Jacob, please go on.
So in many of the results, you have to assume that the boundary does not have any cusps.
In most of them.
Yeah, in the last one you have a result for a cusp. So my question is why are cusps dangerous? What breaks down?
Okay, you have to go to the analysis. The cusp is something very specific. You have to have very specific tools. Most of the results I said about piecewise analytic without cusps. The restriction that it should be not a cusp comes from this paper here. Let me see. Constructing approximation. Let me see where it is. Yes, here, with this one here. Because it is required in the analysis. You cannot do it. Actually, if you have a cusp, we cannot go inside to extend analytically your conformal mapping side, because you use reflection principle or source Christoffel function. If you go to this paper, it was mentioning exactly why you cannot do, at least with the case where you have a zero interior angle. Yes, so it's out of cusp. And in many cases, for example, cusp do not work for the quasi-conformal case, because if you have a piecewise analytic curve, it is quasi-conformal if and only if has no cusps. So you lose a great deal of tools. But here in the Lehmann's expansion, the angle pi is permitted because it doesn't present any difficulty in the expansions. Or you see, if omega here is two, so you have 1/2 here and there. But if it's zero, it cannot work. So that was the reason about the discrepancy. Thank you very much.
Yeah. Thank you.
Okay, other question?
Yeah, I would like to ask Nikos, about I heard that your results with Etzav, Bern-Bickermann for behavior, asymptotical behavior of Christoffel.
And Mihai Putinar. Also
Mihai Putinar. I use it for this big data analysis. If it's not so long, could you briefly say us how you do it? Yeah, why don't you actually do it?
Okay.
Because our administration forced us to do something useful. Yeah.
I can say something, but since Bern here,
we'll tell us.
The idea is to separate the outliers from the big data. I'll give you an example, perhaps. You have, let's say, as in the States, they have detectors, 1 million detectors around the land in order to anticipate or foreseeing earthquakes, let's say. And then this detector said to a sender, all the time they are sending measurements, data. And at some point, a number of them go wrong. They are defeated. So how can you tell, as this huge data is coming in, that some detectors went wrong? So you want to separate from the huge, massive information, the outliers. So the idea is to compute one of the, at least we used in the first paper with Gustafsson and Putinar and the SAF, is to having the reading, even the reading of this, the reading is actually the moments with respect to some point measure, okay? Point measure, even some unknown measure. But you have the moment, so this is your information. Then having the moments, you construct the Bergman polynomials in this Arnoldic way, which is stable. And then from the Bergman polynomials, you have the diagonal of the Christoffel, you have the Christoffel function, you compute the Christoffel function, you use the square root because it behaves better, and then you plot out the level lines. That's what we did. And remarkably, the plot lines, we come go inside the island, because outside the island, we have shown that they decay extremely fast. So this is the idea about.
Yeah, okay, thank you. And I have also some personal thank to you that you remember a paper of Murmon Ambraladze. He was also like me and Valery, student of Nikishin in 80s.
Oh, I didn't know
that. In 90s, it was not so comfortable living in Georgia. He came to Moscow and we discussed all these things, and then he went to Sweden and been a professor with Hans Wallin. Yeah, so it's nice that you pointed his nice theorem. Thank you. Okay.
Important result.
Okay. As other questions or comments? So let's thank the speaker again.